How y'all doing?
Right.
A little jet lag. So I have to say, last night about 10 o'clock, Louis was downstairs, and I went down and I said, hey, could I give a talk tomorrow? Or could I give a talk sometime during conference? He said, sure, how about right after the opening talk? What service? Fantastic. I'm Michael Terry. I'm a professor at the University of Waterloo, and I'm going to talk about three different things today in this 30-minute time slot. So who I am. So I'm that in GIMP guy. So I'm the guy who took GIMP and then instrumented it to collect data about how it's used in practice. And a lot of the talk today, all of the talk today is related to this project. I'm here with two grad students, so Matthew Kay and Ben Lafreniere right there. Say hi to them. Matt is the guy who did the avatars. So if you were here 2 years ago, you'll recall that one of the things that we were doing with the in-game data was taking it and then building an online representation of how you use the software. And so he's the one who developed those. So very cool stuff. So three things I want to talk to you today about. One is we want to interview you. We want to interview all of you here. So I'll tell you a bit more about that in a second. We also want you to critique a new adaptive UI design that we have for GIMP. So this is still in the design process, and so we're looking for feedback. And then, the final topic is we want to show you how to put the fun back into dry software legal agreements, as if they were ever fun to begin with. But we're going to tell you some work that we do with in GIMP that resulted in visually arresting designs for what are otherwise dry software agreements. All right, to begin with, so we're running a new study where we want to understand how people in the open source community conceive of and act on the notion of usability, right? So how do you define usable software? What are your examples of really highly usable software, okay? What types of usability problems do you think are most important to address when you're designing software? How do you yourself make software usable? So what are your practices? Do you have someone on board that helps out with this? Do you have particular tools, methods? Basically, how do you make your software as easy to use as possible? Okay, so we want to understand this. The reason why we want to understand this is that this type of information will help us design new tools and methods for helping create usable open source software, right? So there's been a number of projects in the past where they've sent out surveys and questionnaires about, you know, how do you develop software in the open source community? They might have touched on some issues of usability. We want to be able to talk about how the open source community conceives of and perceives of usability, and we want to tell it in your own voice. So we're looking to interview people. The interviews will last 30 minutes or so. Either myself or my students will probably approach you at some point in time, seeing if we can borrow you for 30 minutes and really get at these notions of, you know, what you think is important in terms of usability and open source software. So that's the first part of my talk, just sort of a plug for the study we're doing. So the second thing has to do with the data we collected from in-GIMP. So we've been collecting data about people using GIMP for about 2 years now, right? So 2 years ago, we came to LGM and announced the in-GIMP project. We have this huge data set. We have over 5,000 log files now representing over 500,000 commands. We have lots and lots of data about how people use the software. Now, one of the things that stuck out, which I think is kind of interesting, is that people use only about 11 different commands when they sit down and use GIMP. They sit down and use the software. On average, they're using about a dozen different commands, right? So this is 11 out of hundreds. Right? Here's the plot right here. Here's the number of unique commands that they use. It's all very low. They're using about a dozen different commands, right? Now, if there are hundreds of commands and people are only using a dozen of them, right, this starts to get you thinking, right? So if you're a novice, if you're a casual user, if you're an infrequent user, and I think most of the GIMP user base falls into this category, then these hundreds of options can be intimidating, right? Yeah, question.
Do you mean everyone uses the same 11 commands, or do you mean each individual person uses 11, but they all use different ones?
That's a great question. They use different dozen commands. Right? However, just hold on to that, because I got another slide for you.
There are three commands for each every user uses.
What's that?
Three commands for every bike.
there's three commands that everybody uses? Well, there's one command that virtually everybody uses, and that's undo, right? There's a bunch of uninteresting ones. This is true.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah, go for it.
This graph.
Yep.
Why it's different on April? Is it the lack of data or what? It's
so
more dense the stuff.
Yeah, because we didn't release the software there yet.
Yeah, that's okay.
So.
I mean, what's that? August 2007 and.
So there's just. There's people are using it less frequently over time,
okay.
Right? So we haven't kept parity with the latest version in all cases.
It doesn't mean that we lose people who was able to use 25 phones.
No, that's not what's happening. Those people are probably updating to like the latest like 2.6 version. I think we're at the latest one we ever released is 2.4.
Okay.
Anyway. So there's hundreds of commands available. People are only using a dozen at a time, right? So what can we do about it? Well, you know, if we wanted to simplify the interface, there are a number of things you could think about doing. So you could imagine hiding menu commands for menu items that are not commonly used, right? So Microsoft Office does this. But the issue here is that the kind of commands you use are related to your particular task. They're not related to, you know, they're not necessarily related to how recently you used it. So this, I don't think, is a great metric or a great method for simplifying the interface. So you could use something like Microsoft Lake Ribbons, right? But the problem with this is that they assist with low-level tool use, right? So you choose the paintbrush, and you're going to see a bunch of options related to the paintbrush. But it doesn't help you with tasks, right? So when you use the paintbrush, you're also likely to use the eraser tool or the paint bucket, right? And so the ribbons don't help you with that concept. Okay, they focus on providing options for a particular tool. Okay, so what we're doing is we're taking the approach that we're considering clusters of commands that are commonly used together for tasks. So if you mine the in-GIMP dataset, so we've done some machine learning on the in-GIMP dataset, you can start to form clusters of commands that are commonly used in conjunction with one another. Okay. So on the left is one cluster of commands. So you can see auto crop, brightness contrast, convert image to RGB, crop image, flat image, resize image, scale image, select all, sharpen, undo. So again, undo used everywhere. But for this particular set of commands, you can see a pretty clearly defined task that people are performing with GIMP, right? They're loading up an image, they're cropping it, they're making some basic tweaks, scaling it, saving it. Okay, this is one task set. Okay, second task set right here that we've identified: adding a layer, using the bucket, bucket fill, eraser, moving selections, moving layers, using a paintbrush. So this is more of a task set where you're doing things like painting, right? Painting or erasing. You're using the tool to create content where you're using painting-like tools. Okay, third cluster of commands that we've identified. So here you see people working more with like a pen tool, right? So adding anchors, adding paths, connecting strokes, basically manipulating these anchors, working with layers and so on. So another cluster of commands, right? So you go through the data set and you can start to glob together these sets of commands that form clusters. So we want to make use of this and make the interface more adaptive so that you have a particular task. For example, you want to just fix an image, right? You're probably going to be using this first cluster, right? You want to do something like paint. Well, you're probably going to use commands in the second cluster, okay? So we call these things task sets, right? So the idea here is that commands that are commonly used together are related to higher level tasks that you want to perform. We call these sets of commands task sets, and we're redesigning now the GIMP UI a bit to enable people to select sets of commands geared to their actual goals, okay? So we're at the design phase right now. We've started some implementation, but we're really at the phase of getting feedback on the designs. So our design, as it stands right now, you take your palette, you take your tool palette, and now we have four different modes for it. And then you have a drop-down box right here where you can choose the particular task set that you want to focus on. Right? So if you want to do painting, if you want to fix an image, right? What you do is you choose that particular task set, and then it's going to customize the interface accordingly. Okay? So this is the default mode. This is the regular mode you see with the icons tiled in a grid. This is the second mode, where you actually have the commands and you have their names right next to them. So recall, people are using about a dozen different commands. That means we have more room in the interface, right? So if you're a novice and you don't know exactly what these tools are all about, this particular mode is going to give you a bit more help and a bit more description of what the tools are, right? So you list the tools and then their names, okay? The third mode expands on this. And so our current thinking with this is that you choose a tool and then you get a description of what that tool does. So the documentation is closely tied. Now the idea that we have with this is that anyone can edit these notes, and it's a wiki-like interface such that once you make edits here, then those edits will be available to the rest of the community. Right? So you have sort of your documentation in place right next to the tools. So you're a novice, you don't know how to use the software, you choose a particular tool set, you select a tool, and then you're going to get notes right there about how it can be used in practice. Is there a question, or you?
Yes, I'm going to ask something, but not right now.
All right. So this is more of an informational mode. So how do you find these things? So our idea right now is, again, you're going to type in some keywords and say, you know, this is what I want to do, hit search, and then we're going to come up with a set of recommendations of different task sets. You click on one, and then it's going to install that in your task set menu so that then you can choose that task set at a later time. What it will do, again, is it will strip the interface of everything except those commands in that particular task set, right? So very geared towards performing specific goals rather than just giving you everything at one time, okay? So these are the basic ideas of our design. What we're doing right now, so we have code to arbitrarily add and remove items from the menus and the tool palette. And we're taking these mock-ups, these screenshots that you see, and getting feedback from people before we implement further. So we want to make sure that this design is usable, that people are going to be able to make use of it when they sit down, they find it intuitive, and so on. So once we're assured of that, of the usability, then we'll actually continue with the implementation. The ETA, I don't know exactly when we're going to get it out there in the world. So we have some students working on it, but students have the horrible habit of graduating and leaving, and so we don't always have the manpower that we'd like to have constantly. So did you have questions before I move on?
Yes, about notes.
Okay.
If you have questions, we're going to use the mic because we're recording. So.
Sure.
For these notes, how are we supposed to be stored? Two people separately add something.
Right.
What will be presented?
So it's going to be a wiki-like interface. So you make an edit, you're going to get a warning saying that, are you sure you want to save this because everyone's going to see this, right? And there will also be an option to change locale so that you can have localization of the notes.
And markup?
So that's a good question. So probably initially we're just going to be doing straight up text because it's the easiest and we don't have to worry about adding too much extra stuff to render stuff, right? So, you know, we thought about, you know, maybe we'll have something like, you know, we'll embed WebKit or, you know, Gecko or something like that so we can render HTML, but we're like, it's a bit heavyweight, so we'll just start out with text, see if it works, and then we'll grow from there.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. All right, any other questions on the adaptive stuff before I move on? Yeah.
When you add your task list with the three things,
yeah.
In the first one, there was select all, but no other selection tools.
Right.
Could it be that if you aggregated all the selection tools, like box select, circle, blah, blah, the aggregation would fit on that list?
So, yeah, I mean, that's a good question, right? So you're going to have to assume that there's going to be some commands that are so common that you're always going to have them available, mm-hmm. right? But even if we can reduce it down to a couple dozen,
yeah,
you know, we're gonna.
I think my question is probably: could you fit all those selection tools into one icon, and then you could, you know, like the tools that I've dropped down and use like all of them?
Yeah, I mean, there's a trade-off versus it being visible versus it being compact. And I think initially the approach that we're going to take is just make them visible, right? So you look at the designs, and you know, we have like this list-like structure where you have a scroll bar, mm-hmm. And so you know, if you increase the size of the palette, you should be able to fit more on there. They might not all be visible at one time, but it's a good point. I mean, there are certain trade-offs with the design. All right. Yeah, Simon.
I'm not sure how to put it, but I
pretty scared about this, because this actually is a help of RFC nightmare. Because you have no idea, there is somebody coming and says, oh, I want to do this and that, and you have first no idea what status user interface is in. And then you say, okay, use this and that menu point, and he says, I don't have it. So,
right. So
that scares me.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, it's good that it scares you. I think it's going in a different direction. It's, you know, there is no application out there that's like this at all, and so we're not going to get it exactly right the first time. One of the things that we used to have up here was a tutorial mode, so that you could imagine people writing tutorials where you only have the tool set you need to complete that tutorial in your palette, and then a set of instructions to guide you through it. I think, you know, for the help stuff, you know, if you're trying to help someone out and say, you know, they want to, for example, you know, fix the light levels in the software, if you can say, okay, you know, load up this particular task set, then you're just going to have these tools. I think in the end, it's actually going to simplify the interface and their interaction a lot, right? So if everyone has access to these same task sets and you just say, load up this one task set, it's going to have these 5 tools, it's going to have these 10 tools, whatever, and then look at the notes, it might actually simplify teaching people how to use the software.
So I guess we probably should discuss this later, because, well, just to repeat that, I think we need to discuss this later. I'm not sure if this right now is the right forum to do this, but for me, this adds a layer of complexity instead of simplicity.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah. We'll see. I mean, it hasn't been tried before. I mean, so this is why it's research, and you know, we don't know what the outcome is going to be.
It doesn't add layer of complexity at all. This is the standard trade-off between everyone uses the same thing and makes it easier for support and customizability. It's not unique to this, it's true for everything. But the solution is you have one of the drop-downs which says default. You say, okay, the first thing I want you to do is set your task set to default. And you go, yep. You're right, now do this. You can lead someone through it like that. Or if these drop downs could be shared, whatever you can say, what tasks are you using? Oh, I'm using this, and this. Okay, I'm loading those now, right? So that means that the third icon should be a paintbrush. Yes, it's a paintbrush. Okay, good. So now we're on the same page. You can get around this. It's not that, it doesn't have to be a nightmare.
All right, point, counterpoint. I like it when people argue my points for me. Thanks. Right. I'll have to write that. I'll have to watch the video later so I can write that down next time I get a comment like that. Cool. All right. So, but yeah, we're happy to talk with anyone else later about this because, again, it's very formative. This is the time to discuss the pros and cons of the design before we actually get to coding. Okay. So in the last 10 minutes, what I want to do is I finish up by showing you a lot of what we've been doing for the past year with the in-game project related to software agreements. And this was work that was done by Matthew Kay. So there are a lot of boring but important documents that you encounter when you use software, right? So there are privacy policies, there are license agreements, there are service agreements. For in-GIMP, we have this data collection policy. So we have all the information that we collect when using GIMP, okay? These are, and this is an example right here, of our consent agreement. So when you use in GIMP for the first time, you have this long agreement that says, this is the kind of data we collect, you know, here's how your privacy may be at risk, and so on. Okay. So these are important documents to understand, but they're very, very boring, and we see them repeatedly, and so we ignore them. Okay. So what's wrong with them? So you have this very ineffective presentation of the information. Okay, so you have these walls of text, right? It's just all just text. And this is a conference, really, where people are sensitive to this, right? There is no visual design with this license agreement. It's just straight up text, okay? There's not a lot of what's known as hazard matching. So when you get a dialogue, a warning dialogue, when you're using the computer, you might get an informational dialogue, a warning, or, you know, there's been a critical error, okay? These are examples of hazard matching. Right? So this is only paired with stuff that's informational. This is a warning, and this is like something critical. Right? there are no cues like this when you're reading license agreements to say, you know, what is really important about this document. These documents also have very little personal relevance. There's no real, you know, need or perceived need to read these things because you can't negotiate them, right? You either have to accept those terms or you have to continue, right? You go to a website, you have to accept their privacy policies or you have to use something else, okay? And then we see lots and lots of these things. So all of these factors, you know, by virtue of, you know, poor visual presentation, the inability to negotiate the terms of these things, and then repeatedly seeing them, we turn off to them. You don't actually sit and read them. For us, for the in-game project, we actually want people to read this. We want people to understand the project. We want people to understand the goals of it, right? So we set out to redesign these agreements. And so this is our lab space. In the midst of redesigning, we mocked up lots and lots of different ways that you could imagine presenting this type of information to people. We used video. We explored video. We explored word list diagrams. We explored text with illustrations. And so here are some of the example mockups we had. These are all related to the InGIMP project. So all these things are trying to tell people, you know, what we do with the software, its purpose, and so on. So we tested these out, and we found that people ignored all of them, right? So we showed these agreements. And, you know, despite all of our efforts, they ignored all of these things. But we did find that people responded to improved visual design. So when we did improve the design, people felt like we were trying to make an effort to communicate with them. And so they spent a bit more time looking at it. So given this, given the fact that people spent a bit more time, we turned to some experts in visual design. We turn to these trashy magazines you see at the checkout counters and in airports, right? These magazines are financially motivated to get your attention, right? So what we did is we went to the grocery store, we bought copies of Star Magazine, Us Weekly, Glamour, GQ, Time, National Geographic, all these really loud magazines, and then we systematically went through them one by one to identify all the techniques they use to get people's attention. We labeled them, and so this is our wall. These are all the different magazines. So what's funny about this is that there were two of us, two guys, going through these magazines for 4 hours, right? Most of them are geared towards women, and still after 4 hours, we would stop and read stuff, right? So there's stuff that's working in these magazines, and so we wanted to figure out what is their secret sauce? What's their magic formula? So we ripped out examples, we tagged them. You can see we annotated them to say, okay, this is the particular technique they're using. So for example, this is an article right here where they put someone's point of view right here, and they actually put a little picture of the person right there to make it more personal, to feel like, you know, you're talking one-on-one with the person. And so we cataloged all these techniques, and we clustered them together, and so then we had this huge grab bag of visual design techniques we could use to apply to the problem of increasing the visual interest and appeal of license agreements. So we started out with this, right? This is your standard dry license agreement. And then we came up with something that looks like this, okay? So it's a much cleaner design. We do things like have these call-outs right here. So we have these warning boxes right here which tell you about things that are particularly sensitive about this particular agreement. We have these little vignettes, these little cartoons that give you a bit of more information to complement the text. We have some poll-like information related to it. We have pull quotes, so these little factoids about the content of the agreement. So we call this right here a textured agreement, okay? And there are really four different techniques we have employed here. So we have information layering, so we do things like make the headings very clear. These are standard practices in graphic design, they just haven't been applied to license agreements. We have these little vignettes, right? So we have these little comics that talk a bit about what the software is doing. So for example, we're collecting command names, so we do this in InGIMP. We have a case right here where it's showing a bit of information that the user's really surprised they're collecting information about. So it's like, what? What's going on here? You're actually getting that information? And so this particular technique we call sensationalism. So you see this a lot with your trashy magazines. It's like very loud and in-your-face kind of communication. But in this case, we're bringing attention to the more alarming parts of the agreement. And then we have visual variety. So we vary the types of graphic design elements that we use throughout the document, so there's always something new and interesting to look at. Okay? So we did an experiment with these things to see if people actually stopped and read them. And what we did is we asked people to come in and evaluate three different pieces of software to tell us which one was the most usable. So it was a complete deception study, right? They think, okay, I have to install the software and figure out which is most usable. Really, the whole time, what we're doing is we're measuring how much time they spent with the agreements, how much they scrolled through it, and so on. And then afterwards, we asked them a bunch of questions related to the agreements. So these are four of the five conditions we had. So this is our control condition, where we just have regular text. This right here is what we call the PowerPoint fluff condition. So we just throw random graphics on there, right? They're not supposed to enhance the content at all, right? This is to see whether, you know, if the just having these random graphics are enough to cause people to stop and look. And then we have a moderate application of the techniques right here. And then here we have like an over the top application where we tried to put as many of these techniques in one agreement as possible. And so this looks much more like the magazines you get at the checkout counter, right? Very loud, visually loud. So what did we find? Well, we had 84 participants, about half females, half males, and we gave them $10 for the study. We increased reading time significantly. So in the control condition, where it's just your regular text, people spent 7 seconds on that screen. That includes the time to click I accept and next, right? So they're not reading those agreements, okay? We increased the reading time by about 30 seconds for the heavy and moderate conditions, and then for the fluff PowerPoint conditions, there was no difference between that and the control. So it wasn't just enough to go and put these random graphics on the license agreement. You actually had to work with the visual design to emphasize the content and show people that it's personally relevant. Now, did people actually read them, right? So they spent more time. Well, we asked them, you know, how much did you read? And again, we found that people were reporting that they spent more time reading our versions of the agreements than any of the others, okay? And they have comments like this. So they say, well, it got me to read them when I install other programs. I never read them. Big letters, organized points, cartoons, all that help. I think the organization was the most important. So the take-home message here is that visual design does make a real difference, okay? Even for documents as dry as legal agreements, okay? What we find useful is that if you give people intrinsic motivation, if you show it's worth their while, it's personally relevant to them, they're going to take the time to read. If, on the other hand, you try to do tricks, like give them an artificial task to perform, like they have to scroll all the way to the end before they click accept, we think these things are bound to fail. And the reason is, when you get to that screen and you can't click accept, then your new task becomes, how do I go and enable that button? Right? And so you ignore the actual content. So we think the best approach really is to motivate people to read it by making these things visually appealing. So the final take home is that you can use these techniques when you need to get people to read stuff you want them to read. So if you have agreements, if you have, you know, dry documents that you think are nonetheless important, if you take the time to visually design them, then you're likely to increase the chance that people will actually read them. All right. So that's my talk for today. Again, we'd love to interview you while you're here about usability. I'd be happy to take any other questions, and I need to thank our funding sources. So we have a number of grants that we've received from NSERC here in Canada to support this work. Thanks. Yeah, question. So we did have a comprehension test. It's a great question. What we found is that our comprehension test was unduly difficult. So there were three pieces of software that they had to install, right? Each with different terms. At the end, we said, okay, here are some terms of the agreements. Tell me which of the agreements this term is in, or whether it's in any of them at all, right? Now, the issue is that they had no idea that they were going to be tested on this later, right? So they had no motivation to go and lock this into long-term memory. They probably looked at it and then moved on. And so we're doing a follow-up study where we're going to improve the design to make it easier for us to test comprehensibility. But there are two points to note with respect to that. One is that, again, people spend significantly more time, and people self-report spending more time reading these things.
But you don't necessarily have to test, did you see this in the agreement? You could, another way to put it is to say, well, tell me what you understood of this, and see if it matches, in general, the four features that you wanted to convey.
Yeah, that's one option. We wanted to have, I think as much as possible, we wanted to automate the processing of the data. That would have, increased the load a bit. We're trying to run about 90 people with it, and so that would have taken a bit more time to process the data, but interesting alternative to think about.
So first of all, that's great work, reverse engineering market-tested design techniques. Instead of asking a design professional what to do, you find out what's actually being used. That's great.
Thanks.
You realize that the job that you're testing is almost minusculely small. Most people who write license agreements don't want people to read them. They just want people to play okay.
Right.
I'm fascinated to see a study where license agreements have terms like, and you will give your first born child to say.
Right.
Because you'll find that most people just go, yeah, whatever, and they won't know. Right?
Right. Now, this is a great point, and it's something that I had a slide for this exact point, but I took it out in the interest of time. So, do companies want you to read these things? Well, adware and spyware, probably not. Would Richard Stallman want you to read and understand the GPL? Probably. So I think there are instances, especially in the open source community, where for political or philosophical reasons, people want you to read and understand these different license agreements.
Which is to be admired. I'm just saying that I think most license agreements, that's not the design goal.
So I'm going to also take issue with that again, because in a different way. So we gave a talk to some lawyers about a month ago, and they said, you don't want to be in court where people are claiming they didn't read your agreement, right? And
hence,
so
the scroll bar, right? Because it's,
yeah,
we can prove that you made it to the end.
Right.
That's
so, right. So I think lawyers are actually motivated to have they want you to read these things as well.
I just have a comment on this idea that you should be able to configure Git using different test sets.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning. And I think that's one fundamental problem with that is that it's an attempt to create a program that can do everything.
I think the program is already situated like that. and I think what we're trying to do is... What's that?
I would call it a problem, because if you... For example, I'm going to say that users would like to...
So we don't know. I mean, we're speculating, right? We never had an application like this before. So until we throw it out there and we test it, I mean, it's unclear whether people are going to adopt this or not. I think there are a lot of compelling reasons why people might want to adopt this. It's a matter of actually throwing it out there and testing it to see whether, this is going to work in practice or not.
I think it's just a big risk to end up in a mess if you get a program that tries to do everything. If you concentrate on a specific user group, then it's easier to make it really good for that. I guess some experimentation is better to see what works and what doesn't. Mm-hmm.
All right. One more, or do we need to move on?
Well, just a quick question.
Yeah.
If you strip the legalese, just as a legal agreement, does it still have the full force of law behind it, or?
Yeah, if you strip the legal terms from the license agreement, does it still have the full force of the law behind it? Or
right, so this is a great question. So our techniques do not change the underlying content.
Okay.
At most, we add or visually embellish the content. And so fine print in legal agreements works just fine, and it's legal. And so you can imagine these embellishments, which are actually intended to aid comprehension, are going to be fine.
All right.
Thank you.